He studied at the University of Paris, where he taught philosophy after obtaining his degree of Master of Arts. Here he met Ignatius of Loyola and was enrolled as one of the first of seven Jesuits. They decided to go to the Holy Land, but war between the Turks and them prevented this. So for a time, Francis labored at Padua, and Rome. In 1540, Ignatius chose him as the first missionary to the Portuguese East Indies. Francis sailed from Lisbon on the four papal brigs, making him nuncio with full powers and recommending him to the Eastern princes. He landed at Goa in India and began a vast apostolate lasting over 10 years. Here he instructed the adults, gathered the children by ringing a bell in the street, catechized them, and also visited the hospitals and prisons. He then turned to the native Indians, teaching the simple, diversifying Catholic doctrine and fitting verses to popular tunes. He then went on to Cape Comorin and began the conversion of the Pobaras, some days baptizing so many that at night he could not raise his arm from fatigue. Then to Travancore, where he founded 45 churches in various villages. Then to Malacca and Malaya, and for 18 months from island to island, preaching and instructing baptism. On his return to Goa, he heard the vast harvest of souls awaiting the laborers in Japan, and he set out for this field with several companions, arriving at Kagoshima in 1549. He set himself to learn the language and started to preach and teach with such success that 12 years later, his converts were still retaining their first fervor. In 1551, he returned to Malacca to revisit his converts in India. Now a new goal loomed up before his eyes, pagan China, but he was not to reach it. Arriving on the island of Santon at the mouth of the Canton River, he became ill of a fever and would have died abandoned on the burning sands of the shore if a poor man named Alvarez had not taken him to his home. Here he lingered for 2 weeks, turning between spells of delirium and finally died, his eyes fixed with great tenderness on his crucifix. He was buried in a shallow grave and his body covered with quicklime. But when exhumed 3 months later, it was found fresh and incorrupt. It was taken to Goa, where it is still enshrined. St. Francis Xavier was proclaimed patron of foreign missions and of all missionary works by Pope St. Pius X.
Thank you. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. And as we begin our liturgy today, we have the fifth graders helping us to pray the Mass. Where are you? The grade is helping us. Raise your hand. Okay. I want one volunteer who was not responsible for doing anything else in the Mass to come forward and to light the first candle of the Advent wreath. And today, we celebrate the feast day also of St. Francis of Assisi. And now, as we begin, let us ask the Lord Jesus to forgive us our sins. I confess, Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and what I have failed to do. My fault, for my own spirit's fault. And therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ
have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, through the preaching of St. Francis and Xavier, won many peoples to yourself. Grant that the hearts of the faithful may burn with the same zeal for the faith, and that the Holy Church may everywhere rejoice in an abundance of offspring. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Thus says the Lord, but a very little while. As Lebanon shall be changed into an orchard, the orchard be guarded as a forest. On that day the deaf shall hear the words of the book, and gloom out of it, and gloom in darkness. The eyes of the blind shall see, the lowly will ever find joy in the Lord. The poor will rejoice in the Holy One of Israel, for the times will be no more, and the arrogant will have God. All who are alert to do evil will be cut off. Those who were condemned as a man, should snare his offender at the gate, and leave just man in an empty land. Therefore, thus says the Lord, God of the house of Jacob, who redeemed Abraham. Now Jacob will have nothing to be ashamed of, nor shall his face grow pale, when his children see the work in my hands and his mist, and shall keep my name holy. Thanks be to the Lord God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
As Jesus passed by, two blind men followed him, crying out, "Son of David, have pity on us." When he entered the house, the blind man approached him, and Jesus said to them, "Do you believe that I can do this?" "Yes, Lord," they said to him. Then he touched their eyes and said, "Let it be done for you according to your faith." And their eyes were opened. Jesus warned them sternly, "See that no one knows about this." But they went out and spread the word of him through all the land. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This past Sunday, we began the special season of our church year, our liturgical year called Advent. When I was going to high school, I took 4 years of Latin. Advent comes from the Latin, venire, which is come, and ad means to. So that to come is what the literal translation of Advent means. Well, to come. Whose coming are we anticipating? We are anticipating the coming of Jesus Christ. And if you listen very carefully to the words of the gospel on Sunday Mass, the first two Sundays talk about Jesus coming in a future time where his glory will be established. And then the following two Sundays, third and fourth, focus in on Jesus coming to us as a child, the birth of the Messiah, so that we have a coming that we anticipate. Coming of Jesus that he promises somewhere at the end of time, and the coming of Jesus as a child into the world. And in between that is us. We believe that we live between those two comings. Well, does that mean Jesus is not going to come to us? No, he does. And there in these two comings, we've got to believe that Jesus too comes to each of us in different ways, that we have to be open to his presence, so that Advent is a time for us to be open to the presence of Jesus coming in love, coming in forgiveness, coming in smile, coming in someone who helps us, coming in someone who stands up for us. These two are the coming of Jesus to us in the world. Now, we have how many candles on the Advent wreath? 4. Okay? Well, I kind of alluded to it already. The 4 candles stand for the 4 Sundays of Advent. And last Sunday was the first Sunday, so we lit 1 candle. And this coming Sunday will be the 2nd Sunday, and we will light the 2nd candle then. Well, then we have 3 purple candles on our Advent wreath. Well, purple is the color of Lent and Advent, so that for this Advent time, the priest wears the color purple if there is no special feast day. Well, today is a special feast day of St. Francis Xavier, a priest and doctor of the church, so that I wear white. But Now, as we look at that Advent wreath, well, the wreath is round. Well, and also it's green. Well, the green round wreath says, points to everlasting. A circle goes around and around and is everlasting. And that color of that circle is the green of evergreen. So that it's always green. So that we always have the life of Jesus with us. That Jesus is always there. Now we have also, we have a pink candle. That pink candle stands for the third Sunday of Advent. And the third Sunday of Advent is known by another Latin word, Gaudete, which means rejoice. And therefore, a pink is kind of a celebration of rejoicing that we are halfway through Advent and we are approaching the celebration of our Savior's birth once again. So we're getting excited and we are anticipating that. So then this coming Sunday, we will light the first candle and then we will light the second purple candle for the second Sunday of Lent. Now, we talk about a church year. Well, when do we celebrate our new year for our calendar? Our new year. What's the day of the new year? January what?
January 1st.
Yeah, January 1st. So that's the new year of our chronological year. Well, the church year doesn't follow our chronological year. And our church year has its own markings of time. So that we celebrated 2 weeks ago the Feast of Christ the King. And that was the end of our current church year. And then the following Sunday, we started a new church year. And that new church year is the first Sunday of Advent. And during a church year, we have three sets of gospel readings. This past year that just ended, this was in readings from the lectionary called B, and that was readings from the Gospel of Mark was emphasized. So now, as we begin the second, our new church year, and disciples called C, what we have now is we will be hearing throughout the church year the emphasis will be on the readings from Luke. And of course we have four gospel readings, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then John's kind of his own set of readings, so that we have a three-year cycle for our church readings, so that we have a variety that we listen to every church year, so that we honor the church year by honoring us as we begin Advent to come, Ad Venire. And then halfway through, we light the pink candle, which means Gaudete, to rejoice as we rejoice because Christmas is so close. Now, I'd like to say a quick Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, that one of their special callings for the Jesuits is education. And St. Francis Xavier believed in the importance of education. Now, he was a learned man. He was a missionary. He went out to proclaim the good news of the gospel to places that never heard about Jesus. Now, this was during the 1500s. So we have St. Francis Xavier went to India to spread the gospel message, went to Malaysia to spread the gospel message, and went to Japan to spread the gospel message. Now, he died at the age of 41. He didn't live a long time. But in that time, that short period of time, it is said that he baptized 30,000 new Christians who were welcomed into the faith. Now, what I'd like to do is, I'd like to close with a little reflection about Advent from our Holy Father, Pope Francis. So I want you to listen to this reflection. Advent invites us to commit to vigilance, looking beyond ourselves, expanding our mind and heart in order to open ourselves up to the needs of people, of brothers and sisters, and to the desire for a new world. Now, let us present our needs to our loving and compassionate God. Prayer of the faithful.
There may be harmony between our words and actions, so that in all things we witness to Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That in every place of war, violence, terrorism, and religious persecution, there may be peace and the people live in safe houses. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Thumbs up. So we have to pray for his continual Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we are offering up this Mass for our St. Catherine of Alexandria school students, for our religious education students, for our teachers, for our catechists, and all staff members. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God our Father, look favorably upon all our petitions that we bring to you with trusting hearts. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
Lord, accept the sacrifice of your hands. Pray, the Lord, and the warriors,
and the Lord, and all the churches. Receive, O Lord, these offerings we bring you in commemoration of St. Francis and Xavier, and grant that as he journeyed to distant lands, out of a longing for the salvation of souls, so we too, bearing effective witness to the gospel, may with our brothers and sisters eagerly hasten towards you through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts, and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For on this feast of St. Francis and Xavier, you bid your church rejoice. So too you strengthen her by the example of his holy life, teach her by the works, the words of preaching, and keep her safe in answer to his prayers. So in the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your prayers, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
time he was betrayed, and entered willingly into his passion. He took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more gave me thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Thank you.
God, kindle in us that fire of charity with which St. Francis and Xavier burned for the salvation of souls, so that walking evermore worthily in our vocation, we may obtain with him the reward of your promise to those who labor well in your vineyard through Christ our